Bye, Mr. Taru. In my second video about parametric equations, we're going to take most of the examples that we just used in the previous video where we graphed them using t-tables and put those parametric equations together and eliminate the parameter, or basically convert them into just regular rectangular form or function form. So we're going to try and get these, well, y in terms of x, or in the case of a couple of our final examples where we have conic sections, put those conic sections into standard form. Well, this is just basic algebra. I don't have any trig functions. So I'm going to do substitution to get rid of the parameter t and do it in a way that I end up with y in terms of x. So we're going to take this equation, we're going to subtract both sides by 3 and get x minus 3 equals t. And now that we know what t is equal to, we're going to take what it's equal to and plug it into the other equation and get y is equal to negative parentheses x minus 3 squared. Okay, that is y in terms of x. I could take this binomial and FOIL it together or distribute it out. I hate the word FOIL, sorry about that. But I'm going to take this binomial and distribute it or square it and just expand it and have it in general form y equals ax squared plus bx plus c. But we did just study parabolas in standard form. So I can take this equation, divide both sides by negative 1, and get negative y is equal to x minus 3 squared. And if I really wanted to push the idea of getting this into standard form, I can turn this around and get x minus 3 squared equals negative y. Well, this is a parabola with the x being squared, which means the parabola opens up either up or down, and my coefficient of my single degree term is negative. So my 4p value is equal to negative 1. So this is a parabola opening down. So this is a parabola with a vertex at 3, 0, which opens down, which is exactly what we had in the, I believe, the first example in the last video. So here's our equation, and I'm sure your teacher, as well as myself, would accept either one of these answers for these, where you'd say, here's some parametric equations, eliminate the parameter. Our next example is going to be x equals the square root of t plus 1, and then over here we have y equals t minus 2. Okay, so we want to get this into, I keep wanting to just say get in rectangular form. We want to eliminate the parameter. Again, you can do the substitution in any order you like. I'm kind of getting stuck on the idea of having y in terms of x. So I'm going to take this equation and I'm going to square both sides to get rid of the square root. And we get x squared equals t plus 1 and x squared minus 1 equals t. And now that we know what t is equal to, we're going to take, again, what it's equal to and plug it into the other equation. And you don't always have to, do this with the x equation and plug it into y. That's just what I'm doing. So we have y is equal to whatever t is, which is x squared minus 1, and then minus 2. So we have y equals x squared, and negative 1 and minus 2 make negative 3. I use the parentheses because it's habit for substitution. This t had no leading coefficient, had no divisor, had no power, so really those parentheses aren't doing much except for reminding me that that's where I did my substitution. We have a upward opening parabola with a vertical shift down of 3. This would be more like your general form of a parabola. Our next example, well, I don't know. Let's see what happens. There we go. So we have x equals 4 sine t and y equals negative 3 cosine t. Okay, to substitute these equations in together and only get one function and eliminate the parameter of t, if my only goal was to get rid of t and to do this problem like I did my pure algebra question ones where there's just, you know, squares and square roots and pluses and minuses, no trig functions. I would have to do some kind of weird inverse trig function, have maybe something like x equals 4 sine of some kind of inverse cosine function. It's going to get ugly. So what we're going to do instead is I've got sine and cosine in these equations, and I'm going to just remind you, because we're going to use this in a minute, that sine squared t plus cosine squared t equals 1. You would have said theta when you were studying your all your trig identities. So we're going to make this show up in these two parametric equations after we've combined them. So I want to use that parametric, that Pythagorean identity to help me clean up these parametric functions and get a rectangular function, or in rectangular form. So I'm going to square both sides of these equations. So I'm going to square both sides and get x squared is equal to 4 squared, which is 16, and sine squared, which is, well, sine squared t. And to be honest, I just paused there for a second because I've been in class with my students, getting rid of the leading coefficient first really is best to get rid of or isolate the trig function first before you square both sides. I got away with it in this one because there was only one term. So in this example, or on this side, I'm going to go ahead and divide both sides by negative 3, get y over negative 3 equals cosine t, and over here now I'm going to divide both sides by 16. I don't know why I'm trying to take care of both at the same time, but x squared over 16 equals sine squared t. Now, I need, sine squared plus cosine squared equals 1. So I need my cosine to be squared as well. So I'm going to square both sides of that equation. And when you square a fraction, you have to square the top and bottom. So y squared over 9 equals cosine squared t. Now, I want sine squared plus cosine squared, so I can let the entire expression equal 1. Sine is on the right, or sine squared is on the right. Cosine squared is on the right. I'm going to add these equations. Now, I don't know how you feel about that. You go, well, how is he able to do that? And by the way, the answer is going to be x squared over 16 plus y squared over 9 equals sine squared t plus cosine squared t. I added the two left sides of the equations, and I added the two right sides. Probably should have had it stacked so the left sides were on top of each other and the right sides were on top of each other. And then sine squared plus cosine squared is going to be equal to 1. So I can just erase that sine squared plus cosine squared and just let it equal 1. And now you can see why I knew that example I graphed in my last video was going to form an ellipse. It's because I've already done the problem. And also, if you know how to take parametric equations and put them into sort of like a regular rectangular form function, you can see that we've got two squared terms. Both of my terms have the same sign. In this case, they need to be positive. And I have different denominators. My a value is going to be 4, and my b value is going to be the square root of 9, or 3. Getting back to this sort of idea where I was able to just add the equations, you do realize that's not a foreign idea to you. You have been solving linear equations, linear systems of equations since algebra 1, where they said maybe, just as a little side example, I'm not going to finish this, but x plus 3y equals 7, and let's say 2x minus 3y equals 4, and I gave you this linear system of equations and asked you to solve the system, find out where these two lines intersect. And what did you do? You did it with graphing, which wasn't very good when decimals are involved. You did it with substitution, and you did it with something called linear combination, which just said create opposite numbers in front of one of your variables and then add the equations, and you get 1 plus 2 is 3x. These are going to cancel out, and you get, 7 plus 4 is 11, and you dot, 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 you find x, you back substitute, and you find y. So adding equations is not a foreign idea to you, or it should not be. So me adding these two equations and getting x squared over 16 plus y squared over 9 equals 1, that really is okay. You've done that before. Okay, one last example, because I think this video might be running a bit long. Of course, if you watch my videos, you know I always talk a lot and probably over-explain things a little bit, but hopefully for some of you that's a good thing. Let's take a look at this one, that hyperbola one I did at the end of my last example, or my last video. We've got x equals 3 secant t minus 2, and y equals 2 tangent t plus 1. Okay, I'm going to do the exact same process I just did with the last one. And you might want to just pause and see if you can do it. You're going to square both sides. Well, first you're going to isolate the trig functions. You're going to square both sides. And you're going to use one of your three Pythagorean identities. It relates sine secant squared with tangent squared. Okay. We're going to add 2 to both sides and get x plus 2 equals 3 secant of t, divided both sides by 3. So we get x plus 2 divided by 3 equals the secant of t. Over here, we're going to subtract both sides by 1 to undo that addition. We're going to undo that multiplication of 2 by dividing both sides by 2. And we are going to square both of these equations and add them. And what Pythagorean identity are we interested in using or matching up with? This one. 1 plus, well, it looks like an h. 1 plus tangent squared x equals secant squared x, or t. So if I take this and I subtract tangent squared from both sides, I get 1 equals secant squared x minus tangent squared x. And it's bothering me I keep writing x when I'm, just for this example, it doesn't really matter what variable I use, but currently it's the parameter of t. So I want to square these, and instead of adding these two equations, I want to subtract them in such a way that the secant function is first. So I'm going to square both sides. I'm going to subtract them. And I'm going to go ahead and just kind of clean this up a little bit. Secant squared minus tangent squared. So I'm going to subtract these equations. So secant squared t minus tangent squared t. I could distribute out the top, but we're trying to get this, we already know from the last video it was a hyperbola, so I don't want to expand it and get it out of standard form. So x plus 2 squared and then we're going to square the bottom, which is 9, equals y minus 1 squared with a minus sign in the middle. So I don't know why I wrote equals. Y minus 1, and then 2 squared is equal to 4. So we have x plus 2 squared over 9 minus y minus 1 squared over 4. And yes, secant squared minus tangent squared, t, matching angles, is equal to 1. And just to really drill home that this is a hyperbola, and it is the same one that we graphed in the last video, this is a hyperbola because of the two squared terms with different signs, one positive fraction, one negative. The center is at negative 2, 1. A comes from square rooting the denominator of the positive fraction, so A is equal to 3. and B is equal to 2. So there you go. I'm Mr. Giroux. Go do your homework.